wanted to recognize that he's an artist in many different types of art. He's a photographer as well, and he has done installations in other places. We think about him because of his work in Providence, where he's taken these three rivers and created a set of rituals and pageantry around them that last a good part of the year, for something called water fire, which he's going to probably talk mainly about. But he came down to Houston a few years ago to think about Bayou, Buffalo Bayou, and what could be done here. And so it's nice to have him back again to make a kind of reassessment of where they are and what can still be done to make that, to animate that riverscape. And I think he's the only other fourth or fifth generation Californian in the room. Is that correct?
There we are,
Barnaby. Just you and me.
Holding forth.
Anyway, he's a great man and a wonderful friend, and we talk to each other on occasion at a little dining club. So, Barnaby, take it away.
Thank you, Ron. First of all, I want to start by congratulating all of you in the room. Scenic America, the movement 50 years strong, started a revitalization of the City Beautiful movement that has just gotten better and better and better and led to so much amazing development and so much peace and joy for the people around the nation. Billboards were an important first step and still an ongoing battle. I commend you in all of that. I want to talk a little bit about some of the undercurrents for why these things are so powerful and so important. And I'm going to follow the first rule for an after-lunch speaker. We feed you. Now we're going to turn the lights off. And we don't want this to become soporific. So I can't see if anyone's falling asleep here. Now, we're going to go a little bit back to earlier than 50 years, just to sort of set the stage here. Human beings as a species have had a fascination, let's go make a noise, sorry, have a fascination with art that goes back tens of hundreds of thousands of years. And it's a very mysterious fascination, and it's a very deep fascination. And when Gerald Hines and some of his wonderful projects was talking about the fascination with water, we are fascinated by light and water and fire and each other. And these have such deep roots that it's very hard to untangle them. But I'm going to talk a little bit about the art piece that I've created, where I became concerned that the fine arts, with a capital A, which is what I'm in the do often, represents a very small segment of the population, about 5%, and it's shrinking. And we need to do things to reverse that. There was a time when the same motivation for religion, this is St. Peter's Russia, the same motivation for religion about light and water, and you think about the elements in religions worldwide, these are universal concerns. And there was a time when the arts was absolutely central to everything that you experienced in life. And we still think of the Renaissance as a high water. And in fact, there are countries such as Italy, which has basically been living on the investment in art made in that era for the last 500 years. Talk about a return on public art and public investment. These are sort of mysterious and deep things. We are struck by the sublime of natural landscapes. Again, we're dealing here with light. And you also see it captured in many cultures around the world. Romaji, of course, is a famous example where you can just get completely lost in the mud walls behind there in the sense of landscape that our minds as a creative meaning tool change for it. And of course with water, which is a fascination we've had for a long, long time. Then we have this. Made you look. What the billboards have been doing, and advertising in general, is they've been hijacking an inherent system that we have in our brains. And using it for commercial purpose. And it is a trespass on your tranquility and where your mind space should be. And I applaud this effort to engage this. And it's widening that you've done here. I mean, these new mobile billboards are the new things you need to tackle. We build these beautiful public commons, and now under various uses, they manage to poke themselves in front of churches, or here we have Want My Number in the middle of Las Vegas. But this is a tragedy, and it's a tragedy as big as the original one you sponsored. Just another thought. Art is also about aesthetics, and aesthetics applies to everything from the design of buildings to the design of objects. And there's a curious thing about aesthetics and its relationship to truth. These are boats which were built for performance, to perform in the best possible way. And curiously, very high-end design and aesthetics very often mirror each other. You hear that from physicists who talk about the beauty of a particular solution in physics, or mathematicians who talk about a theorem being elegant or beautiful. Beauty is a complicated synthesis of quite a few elements, but this sense of truth and reality and this core grounding come through in many, many ways. You recognize it in church, you recognize it in music. It's a strong relationship between music and mathematics and order and repetition. Architecture has a long dialogue. Louis Kahn often speaks about music and repetition, Edith Corbusier and many other architects. Boat building, so this is the efficiency of the boat, but it's curious that the beautiful boats very frequently perform perfectly. Now this is the equation that you should write down. This is the equation to figure out the right curves for a boat. But this is in order to make AutoCAD work so that you can get those fancy B splines to work to get those curves. But a boat builder, whether it be America's Cup or a fine crafted boat, or a car builder will tell you they start with this, and then they refine it in an actual model by hand, and they look at it by eye, and they respond to the aesthetics of the experience, and that refines the truth of the design. This was brought up to me by a boat builder who asked me, it was a traditional wooden boat builder, he asked me if I've ever heard of some guy named Frank Gehry. And I said, yeah, I've heard of Frank Gehry. He's a pretty prominent architect. And he said, well, you know, he makes these buildings with these curves, and he's clearly, you know, like a weekend carpenter because he doesn't know how to deal with curves. And his objection was that they were so rectilinear and, you know, he ought to talk to a boat builder. We've been working with making curves for a long, long time. And he said, I don't think his buildings would float. I didn't want to mention that there's often a leakage problem of a different variety with some of the Frank Gehry buildings, but it was interesting that he was morally and aesthetically offended by the curves because he felt they weren't elegant enough. And if you think about the overtoned boat as you build its hull, that's where the cathedrals came from. We call it a nave because it came from the same Latin that we have navy or naval. It was this sense of wholeness and gathering under an overturned boat that you were building that led us to the Gothic ideal of the cathedral. And then modern art proceeded. So we started here, and nowadays we're often here. Now, I'm not making fun of this artist or this artwork. I think it's actually a very serious and very interesting and engaged dialogue with what we think of as art, what we're conceptualizing with art. However, we've left so many of our fellow members behind in this discussion. This is legitimate work, quite interesting work, valuable work, but this was easier to relate to, and the larger issues that this is dealing with are dealing with critical issues related to postmodernism and a lot of different, it's interesting, but it requires a lot of background to fully understand it. So we have a couple challenges to art right now, and I'm passionate about design and art making our city a better place. And I'm so pleased with the people you've been honoring and the amazing progress that was documented so far. So we talked about this challenge. And then here we have Bernard Berenson at his house in Florence, Itati. Now this is the connoisseurship model of the art. Perhaps one of the most known connoisseurs of the arts, and a brilliant writer, very interesting guy. But we no longer have sufficient education in public schools or private schools or even time for the subtleties of what Berenson was so thoughtfully commenting on and many others. We also have as a consequence, we have a graying of the audiences for opera, for theater, for classical music, for chamber music, even for jazz and blues. So we need to figure out how to bring all these elements back into our lives, because all of these forms, from opera to hip hop, have a great deal to inform us of, and we've got to be careful not to lose them. And we have a new generation, and what's happening with social media, we had hoped that social media was going to be building a huge commons where we could have a cultural exchange, but instead we're building a silo where now communication isn't happening. And in fact, you see, I love it when I sit down and see a couple having dinner and they're both texting, perhaps to each other, I don't know. But social media is starting a breakdown in the social interactions of people in urban public space, and we need things to combat it. There's some very frightening statistics coming out. Young children who are now staying at home more and interacting through social media are becoming uncomfortable looking at each other in the face. They're uncomfortable gazing into someone's eyes. Now, the reason why that's such a terrifying prospect is we do know that the mirror neurons, which give us empathy for our fellow human beings, develop in learning how to read emotion and having face-to-face interactions with each other, and it happens at a very young age. So we are rewiring our brains in ways we don't understand, but we do need to figure out how to get more people interacting with each other on a one-on-one, person-to-person basis, and that medieval tradition of festivals did that very, very well. Art can be thought of as a functional component of society, and this is after Alain de Botton's book, and I've added a few things and I shortened it greatly, but just to review a few of them. It's about remembering, memorializing, helping to extract and preserve meaning. It's about hope, presenting hope. Hope springs eternal, and it's very often through symbolic means or art. It's about sorrow. We all have sorrows in our lives. Art and religion and theater and ritual, all these things help us process them and put them in a particular place. It's about appreciation, meaning when you go to Rwanji, the garden I showed you, it's through the art of Japan that you suddenly become aware of a very different way of appreciating the world. And that happens through many, many cultures. It's about rebalancing our lives. It can be an incredible change of mood to see a foreign film, for example, or a balletic performance, or hearing an operatic piece. At Waterfire, we present music and theater and things from all over the world, and a woman told me she saw a man in a trance over a bridge and listening to a Puccini opera and aria, and she walked up and stood in his personal space, so she was sort of asking permission to talk to him, and he waited for the piece to end, and he turned to her and he said, do you have any idea what that piece of music was? And she proceeded to say, well, that's opera, that's from a Puccini, and he interrupted her and he said, so that's what opera sounds like. And she loved that moment. This man was in his late 40s, and he'd heard about opera, he was scared of opera, but suddenly he'd been just thunderstruck in the middle of thousands of people in a public street. It's about self-understanding, it's about personal growth, and it's about reverence. Every church tradition around the world uses art in various forms, often music, gathering together, ritual, dance, symbolism. These are very powerful, rich mechanisms which are below our conscious level of why they're operational. Now, art has a couple of areas that make it hard for us to use in a public sector, because art can in part be a private journey, and it could be self-expression for an individual, and it can be an outreach to others in the sense of this is my vision, and it can be personal learning. This is a perfectly valid ways of art, but this isn't the type of art that can build what we call civic ritual or civitas. Art also is a commodity. It's a fashion statement, it's a status totem, it's a shibboleth of belonging to the right circle. Art claims to be very egalitarian, and philosophically it is very egalitarian, But in any social society, there are levels of understanding and acceptance that are difficult to navigate, particularly for neophytes who don't understand it. I was at an opening in New York, ran across an artist I'd never seen, loved her painting, went up and talked to someone who I just randomly ran into at the opening and said, I love these paintings. And she said, oh, she hasn't been painting in this style for months. So again, this, you know, someone super excited, discovered a new artist, loved the work, and was immediately shut down because 5 weeks ago, it turned out, not even 2 months, she decided that she was gonna do some new stuff. And it's subtle, but there's all these egalitarian issues. So although it's open to everybody, it's a frightening thing. We did a seminar recently on public art placemaking with Art Place and a national symposium on that, and a woman told me how terrified she was to go into the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York. And I said, well, that building was built architecturally to be terrifying. Not to scare you away, but to talk about the magnanimity, the immensity of the task at hand and the importance of this and climbing up the stairs and the huge columns. I mean, those are all architectural statements that we're trying to make a statement, and you were correctly responding to the sort of apotheosis that this architect was trying to put in there. But they're desperate for you to come in. There's a wall around it, but it's a crystal wall. It's wide open. Every arts institution, every ballet company, every opera company is falling over themselves to get people to come in and enjoy the art. There's another aspect of art. Art is spectacle, and it can be a statement of power. One thinks of the gardens in Versailles, or in a certain way, the garden in Rolandji, which was part of a very evolved statement of power. If you think of Sun no Rikyu, the tea master, and his battles with his overlord, these were statements of power that were being battled in the negative. I can be more humble than you. They were still very complicated statements of power, and indeed Rikyu was beheaded by the emperor it's debated. We won't go into that. But you have art of spectacle also as a statement of power, not just Versailles, but think of the Third Reich. The Third Reich completely understand the power of symbolic statement. Some of the first experiments on using light in architecture were done by Albert Speer in Germany, and they were based on American examples coming out of Buffalo, New York. He specifically modeled them on Buffalo and used them for political function. So art as spectacle is complicated. It can also be a community festival. We think of Mardi Gras, founded, by the way, by the Chamber of Commerce in New Orleans a long time ago. But based on a medieval tradition of Mardi Gras. And art as, how many rhetoricians are in here? People know epideisis? I thought I saw one hand maybe going up. Rhetoric is divided into a lot of formal categories by the ancient Greeks, and the rhetoric of epideisis was one of the ones they considered most important and which we've stepped away from. It was the rhetoric of ordering public space and public events in order to build cohesive philosophical, symbolic, and moral agreement of the community as a whole. So we think of it now as the funeral oratory, but they were actually as interested in the width of streets and the placement of monuments and where sculptures should go. It was seen as one of the most important public surfaces of rhetoric was to have the arts and architecture and placemaking establish a common sense of civility and symbolism, which leads to art as civic ritual and art as community activation. So after doing museum work, I came back to Providence and said, you know, I'm really interested in trying to marry these two worlds. And because we share far more in common than either of them would be willing to admit. I'm gonna show a little bit about Waterfire, but this is a funny story. We had an event where a nunnery let us know that the novitiates had all voted from New Hampshire to come down to see Waterfire. That this was what all 120 of them wanted to do when they organized buses. They were very concerned about where they were going to park. And every 2 weeks, I get a phone call to make sure the parking place was still reserved. And I said, yeah, still reserved. Just before they arrived, I got a phone call from another group that was also worried about a parking problem. And they had all decided they were coming to Waterfire from New Jersey. They were the Hell's Angels. Now, for an art event to attract an audience that broad, is a problem, you know, frankly. But it turned, they both arrived. I'll skip the four-letter words that I heard from the Hells Angels, but they called up and said, we're coming to see this water fire thing. We don't want no, let's say, stinking problems. I said, well, we don't want any problems either. What are you anticipating? I said, you know, every time we, I didn't know who they were at this point. Anytime we come to town, we always run into trouble with the police. And I said, well, for example, I said, well, you know, they ticket our bikes and stuff like that. And I said, well, do you read the parking regulations? He said, we don't need read no stinking signs. And I said, well, what do you want me to do? And he said, solve it. And I said, all right, give me your number. I'll get back. And he said, no. We'll find you. I said, okay. So we reserved a street, set it up for them. I forgot to mention to the very fancy French restaurant and the other restaurateurs that we'd closed the street and that, you know, valet parking was going to be a little complicated. Just it was sort of last minute. But anyway, they all showed up. And these are not the actual nuns or the bikers. I wouldn't dare have gotten a picture out to document it. But they all came to enjoy Waterfire, and they both loved the event. I got a very flowery note back from the nuns saying, that was amazing. You know, and I got a phone call from Mr. Anonymous, who called to say they didn't get one parking ticket, and he was very specific about that, so I think there may have been some other incidents. But, he was about to hang up, and he said, oh, you know, that water fire thing, that's cool, too. We're stealing your logo for a tat. So, that's a pretty broad range. So let's talk about Providence. Providence was called, quite famously, the armpit of the East Coast by the Wall Street Journal. And it was a very wealthy city a long time ago, before the Civil War, and had a very prosperous manufacturing economy. But as that economy spread out across the world, and first, you know, with steam power and electric power and diesel power, there was a lack of investment in the city and a flight away from it that really left a pretty beleaguered state. And the city spent many, many millions of dollars quite heroically to move all those parcels together, to uncover the bridge, which had been completely covered, to make a park. None of these buildings were there, but they made a park and then sat and waited for people to show up in the park. Well, obviously all those $1 million made a great park, but no one was going to invest in Providence because they weren't convinced people would come to it because it was a city more readily avoided than attended. So I started to think about whether we could make a civic artwork to fill the city with people. And I did it as a one-time experiment, and the community responded so strongly that I haven't been able to stop doing it since. It's been a very interesting mechanism to experiment with, and we've experimented with it around the world, and it's a very powerful series of techniques, and I'm going to share some of those with you. This is the New River Place the city created, and some of the building has happened, and more has happened since then. But in order, you need a pump primer. You need to show people to be there, and you need to get people together. And ideally, you want to get people of all the community to there interacting in ways that are engaging. And we do it with many, many volunteers, and we play off the fascination of festival, people, light, fire, and water, and music. So during all these things, and I'll show a little bit of video at the end, there's music throughout this event. Sometimes it's live, sometimes it's recorded. We use a lot of recorded music because we want to use every conceivable type of music there is. So we'll go from a recreation of a Pythagorean chant from ancient Greece to a contemporary piece we just commissioned, to a traditional piece of opera, to a traditional black spiritual, there's no setup time, we can immediately go. They don't overlap, and there's no talking whatsoever, and you get into a remarkable reverie, and people are so well behaved there. But very simply, our cities must be filled with wonder, beauty, and awe. And the work you're doing and the designs that you are supporting start that way. But we also need to bring people into them, and we need to make sure everyone's included. To live, we need inspiration, we need reverence, we need hope. We must come together in civic rituals of harmonious beauty and glorious ceremony. We hunger for art that creatively transforms our cities and that can genuinely touch all our lives. And we must create art that we can work at city scale and that is deeply resonant with the entire community. That's not Providence. That's the installation in Rome on the Tiber. We must welcome diversity, start dialogues, and foster deep community engagement. So we reach out to many community groups, from the salsa community to the Chinese American community to everyone in between, and try to figure out how can we take your very vibrant folkloric ritual or traditional religious ritual, or we work with the Aymara, which is a pre-Columbian Bolivian religion, and share it in an educational, informative way that puts you on center stage. So I know you have a great festival in your neighborhood, but many of your fellow citizens don't even know what you're doing. We have a deep need as humans to come together as a community to share the immediacy of the lived and the vital moment. And we need to make great spaces, but we need to take one step more. I seem to have repeated that. We must rekindle in all of us a child's deep sense of wonder. And we need economic vitality and passion for the city to flourish. The Army Corps of Engineers, which was responsible for dredging this river, recently, as part of their process, did an economic impact value of water fire, which happens for about 9 months, usually on every second or third Saturday in Providence. And they estimated it brought in $114 million of visitor spending, with 57% of the audience coming from out of state and about 85% of those dollars coming from out of state. And when asked, why are you in Providence? Specifically to come see the trip was in the 92 to 94% area of the out-of-state visitors. So it entirely rebranded Providence, as we did this 20 years ago and have been doing it, this is our 20th year. We need to live where we know we are both welcome and able to join in the creation of our future. I consider events like this philanthropy 101. Philanthropy, as you know, is love of man. But before you're going to invest in the health system or the school system or in, you know, solving the transit problems, you've got to feel you belong to the community, of the community, and you have a participatory opportunity to reach forward in developing its future. And that's what these ceremonies are. This is something with United Way about young givers, trying to get young givers making donations, at 28 or something like that. I'll show a few pictures of some of the events we've done, and then we'll talk about some other ideas. These are some of the fire dancers at Waterfire. This is the Waterfire goes two blocks to the right and about four more blocks to the left. We were elected as the number five best destination to see after dark in the globe, which of course immediately made us wonder who number one, two, three, and four were. So Paris by Nightfall, they came in at number eight. So Providence was delighted to beat out Paris. What we were beat by was Yosemite Valley in the light of the full moon, the Aurora Borealis viewed in Norway, the Milky Way galaxy viewed from the summit of Mauna Kea. Now we realized that our competition had much bigger budgets. And also, we have one day to set this up. These guys had 6 days to set this up. So we really felt it was a little bit of an unfair playing field, but we were happy to take number five. So here's Waterfire, just for reference if you want to find it. This is the E-flat flamophone. It's been banned temporarily by the fire marshal, but we're working on that. So we look for novel and exciting ways to activate spaces. We infiltrate marching bands with the E-flat flamophone, and when we hit the right note, the entire band flees till they get used to it, and then it's great. So we look for unusual ways to bring lost arts. This is an actor doing Commedia dell'arte, one of the traditional origins of theater being presented in the public space. This is a civic engagement. We do a lot of stuff with health and trying to reach out to people symbolically. These are breast cancer survivors, each carrying a torch of their hope and their resolve to beat this illness, and also carrying the message of the need for self-exams for both men and women. This is something to do with the State Department taking young leaders from the Mideast and training them in the local colleges and giving them leadership roles. This was a fun story. This is we got a call from the Pakistani community saying that we happened to have water fire on Pakistan's Independence Day, and they'd reserved the stage in the middle of water fire for the day, and would we do something with them in the night? And we said, that's great. We'd love to do something. About a week later, we got a call from the Indian community, and they said, hey, you know, you have water fire on Indian Independence Day, and we called the Parks Department, and we reserved the stage right in the middle of water fire, and we're going to have an Indian festival, Indian culture. I said, oh, that's very interesting. So I called the Parks Department, and I said, who do you reserve the stage to? And I said, well, is it the Indians or the Pakistanis? And they said, what's the difference? And I said, well, no, there's a difference. So we had the welcome task of explaining to them that they had both reserved the same stage. And wasn't this a wonderful opportunity? I explained to the Parks Department that they were celebrating independence from each other. And of course, it's more complicated than that. But I'll spare the details. But we had a marathon series of negotiations involving the respective ethnic groups up and down the Eastern Seaboard on how this was a bad idea. And we managed to do two separate festivals during the day and combine them in the middle of water fire for what we think is the only joint Indian Pakistani event in the nation. We did it as successfully for 2 years, and it was actually really quite magical. This is some of the Bolivian groups we work with. This is one of the salsa groups playing with a great salsa band. This is the orchestra playing to more new ears. So this is live of the orchestra in the middle of the streets, all lit up as a civic ceremony, but also carried live on the speakers for all the 100,000 people who were there, so that more new ears heard the symphony that night than the past 30 years of their regular concerts, because many of those are the people who come night after night. Also working with ballet, modern dance troupes, giving them an opportunity. These are opera students. We do opera in the middle of the street, where if it's a love aria, they will grab some poor gentleman by the lapels or the t-shirt, more likely, and sing to him. But it's vitally important to get these arts out of the theaters so people can truly understand how powerful they are. These are some of the other installations at Waterfire and some of the sculptors. This is the previous director of Art Place being welcomed by some citizens in Providence. This is a Get Out the Vote campaign about civic inclusion. Providence was the birthplace of H.P. Lovecraft, the horror writer. He had always wanted to write an opera, but never managed to do it, so we wrote it for him. And this is one of the first virgins being sacrificed to Cthulhu for the International H.P. Lovecraft Convention. Which has now decided that every other year they're going to come back to Providence since they had so much fun. This monster is huge, made by a local artist that we work with. But let's talk about Houston, because as usual, Houston was way ahead on this, and in 1998, Guy Hagstead called me up and said, we need you to come down to Houston on the Buffalo Bayou for the dedication of the Sesquicentennial Park, and we came down and did it in 1998, and if you'll excuse me, I have a little video. It's old, you know. Someone turn the damn lights off here. Wait a sec. No, I think we can find it here. So I'm going to show you the very one-day installation we did in Houston. And Buffalo Bayou actually is to be commended, and Sesquicentennial Park. It's grown out wonderfully. When we came there, the trees were like 5 feet tall, and masons were still working during the day. But it's really become a jewel. Now the key is to figure out how to engage people using it. And it looked like I saw many people jogging out there. This is just a little bit of video.
I can find a four-leaf clover, even when the leaves are falling, even in a winter snowfall, and all around. I can find a four-leaf clover.
This is the youth chorus of, there were quite a few local musicians engaged with that event, and it was a wonderful evening that we did that time. So let's go back. This is the hard part. Where's the mouse? Ah, here we are. Okay. So we decided to go to the opposite side of the globe, and if you go straight through the center, the other side is the Indian Ocean, but Singapore was due north of that point. And we actually were invited by Singapore, which is looking at a problem in a, as usual, Singapore's thinking on a planning horizon of 50 to 70 years out. And they were looking at the failure of interaction among the different ethnic populations in Singapore, primarily in the working class neighborhoods, and asked if we could create an event as an experiment, as a one-time experiment, to see if we could get these different communities to engage. Here I am in one of the amazingly long meetings that we had there. This is a long table. You're seeing about half of it there. And every detail was reviewed. I'm sure those of you done projects in Singapore are familiar with this process. We came up with a small group of volunteers who, without me, I'm down in the meeting there on the lower right, but they were being led by their guides, and I get these stories of these great meals and stuff like that. I'm still in the meeting. It went on for days. In the meeting, the guy says, well, we need a little more information. We'd settled everything, unbelievable levels of detail. And he said, we need a little more information about the time that so many people died at water fire. And I said, excuse me? I have no idea what you're talking about. And he said, no, we have the newspaper articles. You can't hide it. You can't deny it. We know it happened. We need to know more about it. And I said, I've been at every lighting of water fire, and I can assure you no one's died at water fire. And he said, we've got the newspaper articles. And I said, well, can I see the newspaper articles? And a gentleman walked down that long tail and presented me with this. Explosion sent two gondoliers and a juggler several miles into Pawtucket. I love the little translation into kilometers there. Surpassed the Chernobyl disaster site in toxicity. Well, this was courtesy of one very gracious Andrew Kim writing in a brown humor magazine called The Brown Noser. We had never seen it or known about it or realized it even existed. But of course, the Singaporeans in their due diligence had uncovered this. I don't know why we were even invited to Singapore, because they thought this was real. And I said, well, no, this didn't happen. And they said, it's in the newspaper. And I was thinking that meant, you know, someone might find it, we have a PR problem. No, that didn't mean that. That meant that if it's in the newspaper, it was absolute truth. And I said, no, this didn't happen. It's in the newspaper. And I said, no, this is a joke. And they said, but it's not funny. And I realized we had a cultural gulf here that was going to be really hard to explain. Irony, black humor, satire. And I couldn't convince them this didn't happen. Finally, the tiebreaker was broke when the chairman said, well, just to be clear, no one's going to die at water fire in Singapore. And I said, we're all on the same page. And we got through the negotiations and went on to do an installation in Singapore. But this is what the Singaporean communities we worked with came up with. And they're really quite, these are signs they came up with. If water and fire can integrate, so can we. Really interesting the way they took that symbolism, which we think of as this binarity between life and death, and active or passive, or water or fire. And these are some of the performers we worked with, and it was a fascinating experiment. Here we are in Rome, doing it on the Tiber. This is the site we worked with. This is part of the installation. It was a fairly long installation, and many people were there. But I had a moment in Rome that I just still savor, because it was just such a startling surprise. When the dancer in the oculus started to dance, and I won't go into the number of committee meetings that involved, I experienced something I had never, ever seen before, which was thousands of Romans falling dead silent and listening to the Arvo Pärt symphonic piece we were playing, and just watching this reference to the Davidian man in the dance piece we did. We had dance pieces throughout the river, but this caught everyone's attention, and we did it for two nights in Rome, and it was a great success. Some of the prospective sites we're working on is in Washington, D.C. We would love to light the fires for the Cherry Blossom Festival in D.C. The tradition in Japan was to see cherries by firelight at night. This is Issa's haiku. This is an earlier woodblock print. So this is it's a way to avoid seeing all the tour buses and seeing all the people and seeing all the crowds and bring it back, as Issa says, like olden times, and to fill it with music as it was originally seen. So that's one idea that we're exploring. I'm fully aware that the National Park Service will manage to wring every ounce of our proposal out. This is Grand Canal Square in Dublin. This is the Paul Loeb House in Berlin. It's the only place where the Spree comes down right to the river level. This is Parc de la Villette in Paris, which would be a perfect site. The Seine is too crazy. We had permission to do it in the Arsenale 2 years ago, and until some clerk found something that hadn't, somebody hadn't dotted something. So we're trying to do it again for the close of the Biennale this year, which the theme is on fundamentals. This is, of course, the Prato della Valle in Padua, exploring Westlake and Hangzhou. And probably the most audacious thing I'd love to do is I'd love to do it at Stari Most, which is the bridge in Bosnia that was built by Suleiman the Magnificent in 1560, which is this magnificent structure that was considered one of the heights of engineering of the Ottoman Empire. And of course, it was destroyed in the Bosnian War by the Croatian artillery. It had no strategic value whatsoever. It's a step bridge. You can't even drive a jeep over it. It was just symbolic value that the Muslim cultures had once been there. And they destroyed it. And since then, the Aga Khan and Prince Charles and the UN Historic Heritage Site have rebuilt it. And what I'd love to do is try to work with the Croatian, the Serbian, and the Bosnian youth who still, although much is progressing there, there's still tremendous animosity. I'd like to work with the next generation to do water fire and thread the needle of the bridge, but more specifically to make a documentary film about what that bridge meant to people as a symbol of culture and continuity and connection across cultures, and whether the arts has the capacity to do that. So that's a long-range thing. But I'd like to close with two things. Joseph Campbell says, I believe people are looking for the meaning of life as much as they're looking for the experience of being alive. And what I would add to that is communities are all very hungry for ways they can get involved to make the place they live better. You see it in tree planting. You see it in people rising to support zoning ordinance change or billboard change. And this was largely catalyzed from, in my mind, by the rebirth of the City Beautiful movement 50 years ago from Scenic America, so I congratulate you on that. And I'm gonna show one more short video, if I can manage the transition. We also think, in addition to incorporating everyone into an arts event, we also wanna incorporate all of life into an arts event. So I'm gonna show you a funeral that we do at Waterfire. We do funerals at Waterfire and proposals and celebrations of birth, and say that as a community, we do need to seek passage through this. This particular funeral is for Dan Foreman, who grew up in Providence, but he was the founder of LOOP, the Louisiana Outdoors Outreach Program, which took inner city youth from New Orleans out of the bayou by canoe. And he died of a heart attack at a tragically young age. And I'm gonna show you, we had many of the youth from New Orleans fly up to his home city with his family, and we put it in the middle of the art piece. We don't announce it. There may be up to 100,000 people there listening to the opera and wandering around. There are lots of different elements. What we do is we try to activate many different places and have the scale of it bring many people there at once. And then someone who wouldn't go to the opera, they'll discover, hey, that's kind of interesting, or wouldn't go to hear Bosnian folk singing, will discover that. But one of the things you might happen upon is a group of people in tears. And this is part of how art processes sorrow. So let's see if we can do this. Okay, so this is Dan Foreman's funeral.
Deep.
This music is playing the entire two-thirds of a mile of the river. Thank you. I'm almost done, and then we can open up for questions. That was in Providence, yes, and many people came up from New Orleans. He was born in Providence, which is why it was done in Providence. And so his family was there. Myths are public dreams. We can completely change our city by what you're doing here. So I thank you for what you're doing. Let's continue the good fight. And remember, this is where we are. So thank you.